You're listening to the audio production of Traveling Light, Releasing the Burdens You Were Never Intended to Bear, by Max Lucado, published by Thomas Nelson, and read by Ben Holland.
Chapter 1. The Luggage of Life. I've never been one to travel light. I've tried, believe me, I've tried. But ever since I stuck three fingers in the air and took the Boy Scout pledge to be prepared, I've been determined to be exactly that. Prepared. Prepared for a bar mitzvah, baby dedication, or costume party. Prepared to parachute behind enemy lines or enter a cricket tournament. And if, perchance, the Dalai Lama might be on my flight and invite me to dine in Tibet, I carry snowshoes. One has to be prepared. I don't know how to travel light. Fact is, there's a lot about travel I don't know. I don't know how to interpret the restrictions of a super saver seat. Half price if you leave on Wednesdays during duck hunting season and return when the moon is full in a non-election year. I don't know why they don't build the whole plane out of the same metal they used to build the little black box. I don't know how to escape the airplane toilet without sacrificing one of my extremities to the jaws of the folding door. And I don't know what to say to guys like the taxi driver in Rio who learned I was an American and asked me if I knew his cousin Eddie, who lives in the U.S. There's a lot about traveling I don't know. I don't know why we men would rather floss a crocodile than ask for directions. I don't know why vacation slides aren't used to treat insomnia. And I don't know when I'll learn not to eat food whose names I can't pronounce. But most of all, I don't know how to travel light. I don't know how to travel without granola bars, sodas, and rain gear. I don't know how to travel without flashlights and a generator and a global tracking system. I don't know how to travel without an ice chest of wieners. What if I stumble upon a backyard barbecue? To bring nothing to the party would be rude. Every travel catalog company in the world has my credit card number. I've got an iron that doubles as a paperweight, a hair dryer the size of a coach's whistle, a Swiss Army knife that expands into a pup tent, and a pair of pants that inflate upon impact. On one flight, my wife Denilyn gave me a swat on the leg and I couldn't get out of my seat. I don't know how to travel light, but I need to learn. Denilyn refuses to give birth to any more children, even though the airlines allow each passenger three checked bags and two carry-ons. I need to learn to travel light. You're wondering why I can't. Loosen up your thinking. You can't enjoy a journey carrying so much stuff. Why don't you just drop all that luggage? Funny you should ask. I'd like to inquire the same of you. Haven't you been known to pick up a few bags? Odds are you did this morning. Somewhere between the first step on the floor and the last step out the door, you grabbed some luggage. You stepped over to the baggage carousel and loaded up. Don't remember doing so? That's because you did it without thinking. Don't remember seeing a baggage terminal? That's because the carousel is not the one in the airport. It's the one in the mind. And the bags we grab are not made of leather. They're made of burdens. The suitcase of guilt. A sack of discontent. You drape a duffel bag of weariness on one shoulder and a hanging bag of grief on the other. Add on a backpack of doubt, an overnight bag of loneliness, and a trunk of fear. Pretty soon, you're pulling more stuff than a skycap. No wonder you're so tired at the end of the day. Lugging luggage is exhausting. What you were saying to me, God is saying to you, set that stuff down. You're carrying burdens you don't need to bear. Come to me, he invites, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Matthew 11:28. If we let him, God will lighten our loads. But how do we let him? May I invite an old friend to show us? The 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Do more beloved words exist? Framed and hung in hospital walls, scratched on prison walls, quoted by the young and whispered by the dying. In these lines, sailors have found a harbor, the frightened have found a father, and strugglers have found a friend. And because the passage is so deeply loved, it is widely known. Can you find ears on which these words have never fallen? Set to music in 100 songs, translated into 1,000 tongues, domiciled in 1,000,000 hearts. One of those hearts might be yours. What kinship do you feel with these words? Where do the verses transport you? To a fireside? Bedside? Graveside? Hardly a week passes that I don't turn to them. This passage is to the minister what balm is to the physician. I recently applied them to the heart of a dear friend, summoned to his house with the words, "The doctors aren't giving him more than a few days." I looked at him and understood. Face pale, lips stretched and parched, skin draping between bones like old umbrella cloth between spokes. The cancer had taken so much. His appetite, his strength, his days. But the cancer hadn't touched his faith. Pulling a chair to his bed and squeezing his hand, I whispered, "Bill, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want." He rolled his head toward me as if to welcome the words. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Reaching the fourth verse, fearful that he might not hear, I leaned forward until I was a couple of inches from his ear and said, "Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. You are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me." He didn't open his eyes, but he arched his brows. He didn't speak, but his thin fingers curled around mine, and I wondered if the Lord was helping him set down some luggage. The fear of dying. Do you have some luggage of your own? Do you think God might use David's psalm to lighten your load? Traveling light means trusting God with the burdens you were never intended to bear. Why don't you try traveling light? Try it for the sake of those you love. Have you ever considered the impact that excess baggage has on relationships? We've made this point at our church by virtue of a drama. A wedding is reenacted in which we hear the thoughts of the bride and groom. The groom enters, laden with luggage. A bag dangles from every appendage, and each bag is labeled guilt, anger, arrogance, insecurities. This fellow is loaded. As he stands at the altar, the audience hears him thinking, "Finally, a woman who will help me carry all my burdens. She's so strong, so stable, so..." As his thoughts continue, hers begin. She enters wearing a wedding gown, but, like her fiancé, covered with luggage. Pulling a hanging bag, shouldering a carry-on, hauling a makeup kit, paper sack, everything you could imagine, and everything labeled. She has her own bags. Prejudice, loneliness, disappointments. And her expectations? Listen to what she is thinking. "Just a few more minutes, and I've got me a man. No more counselors, no more group sessions. So long, discouragement and worry. I won't be seeing you anymore. He's going to fix me. Finally, they stand at the altar, lost in a mountain of luggage. They smile their way through the ceremony, but when given the invitation to kiss each other, they can't. How do you embrace someone if your arms are full of bags? For the sake of those you love, learn to set them down. And for the sake of the God you serve, do the same. He wants to use you, you know. But how can he if you are exhausted? This truth came home to me yesterday afternoon on a run. Preparing for a jog, I couldn't decide what to wear. The sun was out, but the wind was chilly. The sky was clear, but the forecast said rain. Jacket or sweatshirt? The Boy Scout within me prevailed. I wore both. I grabbed my Walkman, but couldn't decide which tape to bring, a sermon or music. You guessed it, I took both. Needing to stay in touch with my kids, I carried a cell phone. So no one would steal my car, I pocketed my keys. As a precaution against thirst, I brought along some drink money in a pouch. I looked more like a pack mule than a runner. Within half a mile, I was peeling off the jacket and hiding it in a bush. That kind of weight will slow you down. What's true in jogging is true in faith. God has a great race for you to run. Under His care, you will go where you've never been and serve in ways you've never dreamed. But you have to drop off some stuff. How can you share grace if you are full of guilt? How can you offer comfort if you are disheartened? How can you lift someone else's load if your arms are full with your own? For the sake of those you love, travel light. For the sake of the God you serve, travel light. For the sake of your own joy, travel light. There are certain weights in life you simply cannot carry. Your Lord is asking you to set them down and trust Him. He is the father at the baggage claim. When a dad sees his 5-year-old son trying to drag the family trunk off the carousel, what does he say? The father will say to his son what God is saying to you. Set it down, child. I'll carry that one. What do you say we take God up on His offer? We just might find ourselves traveling a little lighter. By the way, I may have overstated my packing problems. I don't usually take snowshoes. But I can't overstate God's promise. Unload all your worries onto Him, since He is looking after you. 1 Peter 5:7. Chapter 2. The Middle Sea of Life. The Burden of a Lesser God. The Lord, Psalm 23:1. I'm only 5 feet from an eagle. His wings are spread and his talons are lifted above the branch. White feathers cap his head, and black eyes peer at me from both sides of a golden beak. He is so close I could touch him, so near I could stroke him. With only a lean and a stretch of my right arm, I could cover the eagle's crown with my hand. But I don't. I don't reach. Why not? Am I afraid of him? Hardly. He hasn't budged in 2 years. When I first opened the box, he impressed me. When I first set him on the shelf, I admired him. Man-made eagles are nice for a while, but you quickly get used to them. David is concerned that you and I don't make the same mistake with God. His pen has scarcely touched papyrus, and he's urging us to avoid gods of our own making. With his very first words in this psalm, David sets out to deliver us from the burden of a lesser deity. One might argue that he seeks to do nothing else. For though he will speak of green pastures, his thesis is not rest. He will describe death's somber valley, but this poem is not an ode to dying. He will tell of the Lord's forever house, but his theme is not heaven.
Why did David?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.